You didn't start a home services business because you needed a job. No, you're going somewhere, building something you own. And the fun is only getting started because you're now a member of an elite brigade of service professionals called Guys in Trucks. It's the Guys in Trucks podcast, the show for hardworking blue-collar service business owners who aren't afraid to take care of business. Each week, you'll hear from experts in blue-collar service industries just like yours. Authors, speakers, and successful business owners who may just have that gold nugget you need to get you to your dreams. So buckle up, Git Nation. It's time to take care of business with your hosts, Carter Harkins and Taylor Hill.
This week on the show, we talk with Mark Stoner. He's in the studio right here, and we've handcuffed him to the chair so that he'll sit still long enough to tell us about his new book, Blue Collar Gold, How to Build a Service Business from the Dirt Up. All that and much more coming up on this episode of GIT. Welcome back to another episode of Guys in Trucks. The Guys in Trucks show, it's the show all about having and living the blue-collar business dream. If you can dream it, you can build it. And this is the place where you can find the education, the encouragement, and the mentoring you need to get there and get there quicker with more time left over at the end of it all so that you can actually enjoy it.
That's it.
My name is Carter Harkins, and with me every week is Taylor Hill.
How are you today?
Good, man. And sitting right here at the table is Mark Stoner.
Hey,
handcuffed
guys
to the chair just so he won't get up and run out to the next thing.
I know. It feels good. I always love coming seeing you guys. Just have such a big smile on my face. You guys are awesome.
We're having a lot of fun. And you know, something's happened. You were episode number one for us.
Yeah.
And something's happened since then. I mean, we've done over 25 interviews now.
Right.
With the show. Things are going well. The audience is growing. But we've been really excited to finally get back in touch with you, get you in here and do another episode.
Thank you.
Because you've got some stuff going on.
I do. It's
more than like, one thing, but
you know, he's always got stuff going on.
It's kind of like, you know, you go fishing and you put a bunch of poles in the water and all of a sudden they all have fish on them.
Yeah.
And it feels like that right now on several different projects I worked on, and they're starting to bear fruit. And it's probably one of the most exciting years of my life, really. And there's a lot going on.
Yeah. That's awesome. Do you find that as, you know, because you're pushing a lot of rivers. I mean, you're pushing a lot of fronts and things mm-hmm. going on. Do you find that as you've grown in business leadership, that multi-pronged approach is easier because you've got people now who can execute, you've got maybe a better understanding of business and how it works, and so you know kind of what to focus on?
That's very true. I do find I am able to laser focus right in on what needs to happen to be more effective. I don't know if I think once it starts to get easy on me, I then just add another plate to the top of my plates. It just seems like I'm just wired to look for those kind of opportunities. And I do, you know, want to push the envelope. So yes, I do have a really great team of people around me on all levels, and every single thing that I'm involved in, there's really great people that help me at those. And but I also find it, you know, I do get a little hectic in internally, and I feel like it's kind of a season in my life that I have to push these things through so I can get to motorcycle riding and barbecue, you know?
Right. Which you did a lot. I mean, just in the past few years, as your business growing, you found the time for that. But you're saying now you've just decided, I'm going to set that aside, focus here on what I'm going to do because this is important to where I want to go.
Right. Yeah. These opportunities that come up don't always come up. And, you know, that sometimes those opportunities are a little whisper and they're not necessarily loud, and you have to pay attention to something. So all of a sudden, you know, for whatever reason, things came in and I had to address them and move forward. And you know, our friend Story Musgrave says, what am I going to do with this? You know, when something comes to him and he says, what am I going to do with this? And that rang true for me. And I want to take on these things and say, yes, let me. They all don't fit nicely like you want them to fit. Right when you're ready for an opportunity, comes. No, really, when you're super full, another opportunity comes, and you got to say, now what do I do with this? So, I want to say, you know, take on these things, but then I also want to push through them and see them through, and so I can move on to, because I'm hard on that work-life balance thing. Mm-hmm. I'm like work, right. work, and then life balance, and then work. Mm-hmm. I haven't really balanced those
well,
two.
You know, Taylor puts it this way. So he calls it a seesaw.
Yeah, I don't. Yeah. I just don't believe in. I don't believe in the whole balance thing, because the whole. You know, I can remember a long time ago, and it reminded me this last week when we were talking about Reagan. Going to a birthday party, and the lady that the birthday party was a professional tightrope walker. Mm. And he spent the entire time trying to walk this tightrope. And I asked Kelly, Carter's wife, so how far did he get? And she said, about 2 feet at the most, right. You know. But that's all he did the entire time.
Oh.
So to me, I thought, you know, that's the way I feel when I'm trying to balance my life. Because I've tried that. It's like all my attention, all my focus is on the balancing, you know, and so I feel like I'm just over here and over there and over there trying to just balance instead of just, all right, forget the balancing deal. I need to focus and get stuff done here.
Yes.
Get this finished. Get it, you know, get it done. And then I can come back over here and spend time over here doing other stuff, you know.
That's so, me too.
Yeah. I get it.
Luckily, I have a spouse that understands that mm-hmm. about me. And there's times she just, hey, you know, the Markstone Express, I need to, you know, I need to get a ticket on that, please. Don't forget about me. And so I have to watch that. But she is very much understanding and supportive of things. And she's proud of me. And so I need that. You know, I have to have a home team that is behind me. And, you know, we like to motorcycle ride and do things. I got to make that. But I've never said, okay, I can work till 5 and go home and I'm home 5:30 to X amount, you know, every day and just make it all fit nicely.
Yeah.
I haven't figured that out.
Yeah, I can't either. Mine is like a teeter-totter. It's exactly right. I'm way up here in one way and then you get this accomplished and then we go down and then, I got to come back up and do this again. Yeah. You know, and it just kind of goes back and forth. But, you know, I mean, good for you and Terry, because it's great you have a spouse that understands, because I do too, and so does Carter. Yeah. And
man, couldn't do it without them.
Yeah. So hail to the spouses.
Yay. Yes, that supports everything.
Yeah.
So talk a little bit. I mean, because you've come off of this whirlwind, you know, beginning of the year, you've done a lot just in terms of, you know, building your own, taking the expertise, the things that you've learned, and mm-hmm. you're starting to really get serious about sharing those things with the world.
Right.
Talk about what's going on there and ultimately what's culminated in the book.
So the things that have happened is, you know, a couple of years ago, I really got involved with Larry Winget. He's been a guest on your show. And through that process, I wanted to be a better speaker. So a professional speaker. And so I started to speak at events for entrepreneurs. I started to speak at events for service businesses. And through that, more people said, hey, can you speak at this? Can you do that? And at one of the events in Miami, I was speaking to a room full of entrepreneurs, and there was a book publisher in the audience. And I told him, you know, I told him my story to the audience. And then I had recently written a little book. And there's a book publisher there, and he said, hey, I really like your story. I don't think there's anything blue-collar book-wise out there. It might be a kind of a category, subcategory of a business book or a business class. It might have something, and there could be a few other books, you know, and in that, like, category. And so I wrote the book, and then I had a publisher pick it up and start to – I had owned markstoner.com since the early 90s. I had no idea how I would ever use it, but I just heard, you should buy your name.com. And I thought, I'm never going to use that. Never. And I had other Mark Stoners say, hey, I'd like to buy markstoner.com. I'm like, no, I just think I should probably hang on to it. You know, everybody says get your personal brand, but sometimes that's not so clear what your brand is. Yeah. Who are you? Why would anybody care about your brand? But through this process, I realized I did, my message could work in the blue collar world and in my own story of struggles and successes, that there was something there. Yeah. And so the book is about to come out July 26th. It's on Amazon. It can be pre-ordered.
That's awesome.
And it's also on markshunter.com.
That's cool. So I'm holding this up. For those of you who are wondering what I'm doing here, we've actually just started filming. I don't know if you can see this or not.
There it is.
This is Blue Collar Gold, How to Build a Service Business from the Dirt Up. Yeah. And I've read it. Thank you. So has Taylor.
Mm-hmm. Several times.
We think it's incredible for a lot of different reasons. It's incredibly practical, first of all. I mean, and you're just telling your telling your story. I mean,
yeah.
It's not, you're not trying to put a high sheen on it and a bunch of glossy kind of make it pretty. It's just, hey, I did it this way. It didn't work so well. And then I did it this way and it's working really well and it's growing. And I want to share what I've learned. And I think that's what makes it so accessible and relatable.
Well, you know, it's all I know. You know, they said I need to write my story. It's not necessarily a pretty story. And when you're going through it in life, you think, why am I having to go through all this? It never felt like it was going to be something great. It felt like I should do more. I had hope that what I was, you know, the path was right. But man, the lessons didn't feel so good when they're happening financially and emotionally. You know, it's neat to look back on it and have put together a story that, you know, one of the deals I make with people at the beginning of the book, I said, hey, I'm going to lay my life out there on the line. I'm going to give you everything I got. But if you'll do me a favor and just write me back and say, hey, you know, let me know if it helped you, if affected you. That's the reason I'm doing it, is to hopefully affect change in people and in this great blue collar world that I think is so underserved. Yeah. And so, you know, it's been so neat. There's advanced copies out there, and we've given away at several of the places I've spoken, and some of the places bought copies for all the people in the audience to give out. So I've gotten some early feedback from people, some friends and some people I had never met. And it's just so neat to hear how it motivates them, and they got a lot out of the book. And some people have read it multiple times and dog-eared things and sent pictures of... It's something I never thought would happen in my life, but it's happening.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
That's cool.
I think one of the greatest things that's kind of this theme, and we've talked about it before too, Mark, there's a theme of failure through the book. And, you know, I talked to so many other people that are in your industry as well. And so many times they just are afraid to fail.
Yeah.
You know? And several of them I've said, you need to get Mark's book.
Right.
You know, whether you, if you didn't get it at one of the conventions, man, you need to buy it. Go to markstoner.com and buy his book and read it.
Yeah.
Because you're never going to succeed if you're not willing to fail. So talk about that.
Yeah, thank you. So, you know, you and I have a favorite book by John Maxwell, mm-hmm. Failing Forward. And in that book, it really taught me that failure is a must. It is absolutely a needed ingredient for you to go, you know, to higher places. And a lot of people, when you fail, it feels like the world is crashing down on you. But actually, once you fail enough, you're like, okay, well, that's just part of my learning. I honestly, I literally go into things now knowing we could fail.
Yeah.
Okay. You know, I'm launching a different business now. I'm in the chocolate business as well. And
that's right.
We're getting ready to launch into a mall that we're going to be putting a product in. And I have to lay out a pretty good amount of cash and risk to go into this high-end mall. And, you know, my son was saying, well, you know, this metric and that metric, and have we checked the, you know, the how many people come through there and this and that, and check with other vendors and the mall. And, you know, I'm like, no, I'm not going to, because they have a different product.
Yep.
They have a different feel. They may not know all the numbers of if the business is doing well or not. It could be hidden under, you know, cloak of corporations, and who knows? I was like, you know what? We're just going to do it.
Just going to go for it.
And if I fail, I learned that that's the way we're not going to do it again.
Yeah.
So it's just, I've totally understand that I learned so much more by just getting out there and understanding failure is just definitely part of the whole process.
Yeah. I mean, I so agree with you because the thing about failure is if you're not failing, you're not doing enough. You're not trying enough.
It's true, you know, but people, like, you don't want to fail in key areas, you know, like, you know, what your service is or are you out there, but... You know, you try a new plan, you try a new marketing plan, you try a new app, you try a new software, you try a new business venture, you try a new line of business. You even have to take risks in people. You're gonna have to risk giving up parts of your business to a new technician or an office manager or a consultant. It's all kind of a risk, and we see if it's gonna work or not.
Yeah, and the thing about failing that people forget is you can always get up.
You can. And it's usually not as bad as you thought.
Yeah.
And you can get up, and you can also step back and go, you know what? We're going back the way we did it before. Yeah, right. There's nothing wrong with that.
Yeah.
You know,
most failures are unwindable. I mean, you can
back right up.
Yeah.
I mean, some are not, but overall, the vast majority of things are okay, let me back up and... Okay, we won't do that again. Because a perfect example, we put a lot of money into a different software system that I thought looked whiz-bang. I was sold on it. It showed me all these great things. I tried to deploy it, and it became disastrous. And I could not get it to work. So I said, hey, guys, sorry, psych. We're backing up and going back to the old system.
Yeah.
I spent a lot of money, but I learned a couple valuable lessons of what it has to happen right in my next software move. That kind of stuff.
Well, so the thing I'm hearing, though, and it's true in the book by John Maxwell, Failing Forward, the only way to fail forward, though, is by learning from the failure. You've got to somehow redeem that failure for yourself so that you gain those critical insights. It's the way you fail, right? Yeah. It's not that you failed. It's the way that you fail that makes the critical difference, learning those lessons. And I see too many business owners that are willing to take risks and, you know, they fail, but they're not learning those lessons that help them take, you know, to move forward from that, to use it as a stepping stone on the path to greater success.
That's a great point.
They just keep failing in different ways.
Well, and...
Or the same way.
Yeah, or they go, you know, I tried that once, I'm never doing that again.
Right. Didn't work.
You know, I had a bigger company, I had 6 employees, and I'll never have that, so I'm going to go back to me. You know, and that's how they felt like they learned from failing, but instead of, okay, this went down and... But it goes into what you want in life. You know what I mean? If the why is strong enough and you really want to get to the other side, failure isn't, you know, you just got to go through it. So.
Well, and sometimes I think that people try things because they think they're supposed to when they really don't want what they're trying. And I think that's another thing. They go to a convention, they go and they see somebody that's really successful and everybody's talking about, oh, we're going to go do this, we're going to grow, we're going to this, we're going to that. And in their heart of hearts, they just want to be a one truck or two truck company. Mm-hmm. They don't want to grow, but they think they need to. They're supposed to. And I think that's knowing yourself first and figuring out your why and those kind of things.
And we've talked about this before too, but you know, it's about being comfortable. Like failure takes you right up out of your comfort zone. And a lot of people just like being comfortable. And comfortable is a dangerous place in an entrepreneur's heart. It's a dangerous place in a business person's heart because, you know, you become stagnant and things pass you up and you're not watching the ball, or in hockey terms, you're not watching where the puck is going.
That's it.
You know, and you all of a sudden you get beat. And if you get comfortable, that should be a warning that you need to have a little more fear and a little more risk in your life.
Yeah.
You know that, hey, what am I trying new? What have I tried new lately? What new things are out there? Let me be on the forefront of change, of moving. But that's just that's how I do it.
Yeah.
You know, I know there's a lot of other ways to do it too, you know?
Yeah. Well, you know, yes. And I love that idea. And this is just physics, right? I mean, when you get something off balance, off center, momentum starts to take it from there, right?
Yeah.
I mean, you've got gravity, you've got other forces that start to act upon it. But if it's completely balanced and stagnant and centered, then you don't have, there's no you've got inertia that takes over, right?
I mean,
you've
that.
Got yeah. just this, it's not going anywhere. It's a rock. It's dead. There's no energy in it at all. And so living your life in a way that's just a little off balance,
yeah,
just a little great. Leaning forward, and you got to kind of take a few faster steps in order to catch your breath and keep up. You know, I mean, that's almost a principle, if you will.
I love that. You know, a friend of mine recently, an employee of mine said, you know, sometimes I'm watching you and it feels like I'm watching a wagon out of control going down the hill and the wheels are about to come off of it. He said, just watching how all these things happen. I said, well, we are going downhill. we are yeah. gaining momentum right. and things do start to shake and quiver and vibrate and kind of feel like they're going out of control. But we'll be okay. Yeah. I promise. Yeah. Yeah. I promise we'll get through it, and it won't. The wheels won't come off. I might lose a wheel.
Yeah, I started, but you know, there are the wheels. Yeah. Put it back on, and off you go again. Yeah. 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 Yeah,
that's funny.
Well, you know, there's a reason why they say hook yourself to somebody else's wagon, because wagons move.
Yeah,
you know. Yeah. I mean, or hop on that train. Why? Because trains are moving.
Yeah, let's go.
I mean, these are all things that are moving. What are we waiting for? Let's go. Yeah. Let's make it happen.
Well, the idea that when you're launching a rocket, I learned this growing up in Houston with Clear Lake and NASA Mission Control just being right down the road. You know, the most energy that is expended in a trip outside the atmosphere happens in the first, like,
yes.
you know, 3 miles of the journey, yeah. right? 80% of the fuel or something like that, crazy amount mm-hmm. is expended just getting, you know, overcoming inertia and getting that momentum, getting that forward thrust. And once you're there, then you break through and you can go light years. I mean, distance yeah. is just ridiculous amounts of distance with very little fuel at all, because you've spent it all in the beginning and getting it going.
You know, and these metaphors, I love them. Because it does truly feel like that. And there might be guys listening out there go, I don't quite understand how that affects me and my business. But mm-hmm. when you do get, it is about momentum, and it is about it pushing. Again, if you're comfortable, you're probably not going to push. But I know you guys, you're very entrepreneur-minded. You're going to push that envelope. You're looking at new projects and new platforms to help your customers. You guys are not going to get beat to the punch,
right?
You are going to be on the front side of it. And I think it's that mentality, even, and for me too, I don't want to be beat to the punch. A technician today, just before I walked in here for this interview, said, have you heard of this app that helps us get customers? And I said, yes, I have. I had a meeting with him last week, and he's like, oh, I knew you'd be on top of it.
That's awesome.
But I said, no, thank you for helping me be on top of it, because yeah. I might miss it. So my employees know, man, we are on the very front cutting edge of whatever we feel like we can be. And and you guys are too. I think
it's baked into our DNA. It's actually, it's our employees' responsibility.
It's that bleeding front edge where life happens, man.
Yeah. Yeah. And what people don't realize is, you know, I remember, it's been years ago, a mutual friend of ours, Paul, one day looked at me and said, man, you're a rainmaker. And I was like, and it was in the music business at the time. And I just kind of looked at him and said, what do you mean? He goes, you just make things happen, but they happen for others. And I'll never forget that, because from that day on, what I realized, I watch people. And Mark, you're a rainmaker. Mm-hmm. And so your employees know that.
Mm-hmm.
And that's one of the reasons they're on board and they're keeping you that way, because they know when you make rain, they benefit. You know, yes. the plants grow and everything else happens when the boss makes rain. Mm-hmm. So one of the things I would challenge all of our listeners to be rainmakers.
That's a great point.
You know, go out there and do it, because you're not just doing it for you. You're doing it for your employees, your community. It's just the way you should think. What can I do today?
There's a book out there called Rainmaker, and it's a parable about something similar to what you just talked about. And you're right. When you can be the rainmaker, so many more opportunities come your way.
Yeah.
And, you know, we're in a networking group, and I want to be the rainmaker for that group.
You bet.
And, you know, I'm in the Chimney Safety Institute, and I want to help bring the rain for people. And mm-hmm. you're right. There's a life satisfaction in being yes. a rainmaker.
Yes.
Yeah.
It is.
That's a great point.
And once you realize that you can do that, it's almost like a high.
It is.
Hey, you want to go to the next thing and make rain the next time. Yeah. You want to do it in the next
time. If I'm going to get involved with it, that thing's going to rain.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. We're going to make it happen.
Well, and it becomes, because you're doing it for a reason now that's bigger than just you.
Yeah.
You know, and now it's about, you know, it's more outward focused because, like you said, the rain falls on everybody, right? I mean, mm-hmm. it's... You're by making it rain, you're helping and benefiting other people too. And that's a key difference. I mean, we just went through this process, and I think Taylor might have mentioned it to you recently about, you know, walking through with all of our employees. We shut down our business for 2 days and went through this core values, you know, vision summit, we mm-hmm. called it. And we defined our core values, and we have 8 of them. But we didn't know we had 8 before we started. We went in not knowing what those were going to be. But through that process, we discovered that these are the 8 things that really resonate for us as our core values. And in that process of going through that, what we realized was that our business, we have a responsibility to keep this thing going because it's bigger than just us.
Yeah.
And the people that work for us, the vision that we have for the company is something that they connect to because it's bigger than they are. Mm-hmm. And to, I mean, collectively it's the whole is greater than, you know, the sum of its parts. It's this realization that it's not just about profit. It's not just about making more. It's not about shoving it in a bank account somewhere and saying that we won the game.
Yeah.
The game is different now. And that's the thing I've learned. And I was curious to ask you about this too, as in your entrepreneurial journey. In the beginning, I thought this was going to be about me, right? I thought it was going to be about me getting rich, me doing something I enjoyed, yeah. me building a business that I could wear as a badge of prestige and say, I did it. And, or grow it to a point, then sell it, and then go to the next thing, right? This serial entrepreneur idea that, you know, like, 'cause you're addicted to that high. At least, yeah. you know, for me, it's that startup energy that's sure. so addicting. But what I learned was that as we brought more and more employees into this, as we developed those core values, I realized that for me, the growth that is happening inside me, I mean, you know, about the thing that is about me is not so much the financial reward as it is, wow, I'm changing as a human being. I'm becoming better at being a good, decent citizen in this world, a human being. I mean, that's the thing I want now. The purpose, the reason I get up every morning is because this is how I get better. This is how I do better things. This is how I impact the world. And it's not just about, you know, me and a bank account. It's about much bigger things. I'm curious, is that a similar?
So what's happened to you is very well documented.
Yeah, right.
The Maslow's hierarchy of needs. Mm-hmm. That's a very old and tried and true kind of progress of life, progress of enlightenment. And, you know, it does start off about the money and shelter and the basics.
Yeah.
And when you get into business, yeah, you got to have that. You've got to be out for the dollar. You really hunt it down and make as many of them as you can. So, and then, you know, not to go through the whole hierarchy because I don't have it memorized, but basically every step you're moving up into, you know, safety, and then you move up into importance and certifications.
Self-actualization is one of them.
And then, you know, the top part of it is truly all giving, and it's all giving back. And, you know, that's happened in my business and it's happening in your business. Yeah. And it's a very neat process to understand that it just makes business so much better. And that's the great thing about business is it can be a great thing. You know, and if you watch the news and things, there's a lot of horrible businesses out there and business people and bad, bad stuff. But the majority of all of the jobs created are from us middle to small business owners that are good guys. We're good people. We're trying to do the right thing. And we have we're blue collar businesses. We're hiring people. We're teaching them a trade and we're paying them well. And we're treating them like family. And you know, that is where the best job growth is. It's not having a big corporation have 10,000 people come work there. It's about having, you know, 10,000, you know, 5,000 companies with 2 or 3 people in there, you know, and have that.
But even more important is that those companies that may only be, you know, 2 to 10 people, making sure that they are strong.
Yeah.
You know, that they're rooted, that they're, you know, able to really, you know, continue and propagate that strength in their communities.
Right. Give the small guys the breaks. Give this that you're giving the big corporations. Give us the things that we need to bring people on and get them trained and treat them right and bring that side of it up. You know, there's really a lack of small business help, you know, for mm-hmm. us out here. We're out here on our own, I feel like. And
I
pay the most in taxes, and I get hit with all the regulations and the insurances.
Yeah.
And, man, give me a break. I'm trying to create stuff.
Yeah.
Give me some help, man.
Yeah.
No choice. Well, that's what I need.
And I totally agree. You know, I've heard some things about the Small Business Administration that, you know, try to get a loan through there and try to do this. And people just struggle with them, and they just say, forget it. So the stuff they've got set up doesn't really help.
Yeah.
So, you know, maybe this will hit Washington and get to Congress. I don't know. And tell these doggone people to start helping us little guys. So I agree with you.
I know a lot of small business owners, and they are good people, and they're good for their – they try to do really good for their employees. And, you know, on that hierarchy, if you can take some of the stresses off of the business owners and help us, it's a lot better feeling community and a group. You know, there's just some – you know, just need some help sometimes.
Well, there's been times that I have looked at my bookkeeper and I have made this statement: with what we've just paid in taxes, I can employ three people.
Oh, totally.
I can employ three people, you know, and give them jobs and stability and all the stuff, but I'm paying taxes. So, you know, if people would realize that small businesses really do create places and spaces for people to work and learn. That's the big thing, is to learn,
mm-hmm.
you know, learn skills, learn trades.
Yeah.
I mean, we train here. A lot of people don't realize that. I would rather have somebody that has absolutely zero experience in our business, and we do all the internal training here and train them up the way we know things work.
Yeah.
And same with you.
Yeah.
You know,
I find, and a lot of people say this too, is that I want a guy coming into my business that knows nothing. I'd rather have that guy than a guy that's fully trained and he might be trained the wrong way or have different opinions or feel like he already knows how to do the job. Mm-hmm. Now, there's some advantage to having a little bit of, you know, past experience, but overall, my best, most loyal people came to me and they knew nothing about it. I brought them up from, you know, they might have been in the military or they mm-hmm. may have been... you know, at a restaurant manager or who knows what, even construction.
Yeah.
And I brought him in and made him a chimney guy and a chimney technician. And those are my best guys.
Yeah. I tell people all the time, don't be afraid to hire somebody that doesn't have experience. If you can train them, man.
You know, it's an old saying, if they got, you know, good attitude, good personality.
Yeah.
Man, if I can get that, I can train the rest. But if I get a guy that's a downer or questioning or, you know, any myriad of problems that has to do with a negative attitude or I can't deal with that. I can't train that out of him. That's his filter. He's born with that. I mean, you're going to have to live with that. I can't deal with it.
Can't do that.
You got to move on, man.
Yeah, maybe you can change, but it's not my job.
It's not on my watch.
Right.
Come back to me and when you change.
I told Carter not too long ago, I said, you know, we have a really good business here.
Mm-hmm.
Counseling is not included.
Yeah. That's totally. And, you know, I've been a counselor before, and there's times you got to counsel.
Yeah.
But, man, I had a very limited skill set at that.
Yeah. Well, you know, it's interesting because we've just talked about how in that entrepreneurial journey, you're kind of running a little bit off balance, you know?
Yeah.
And so one of the things I love to do is ask, you know, questions about looking at it from the other perspective, right? Empathy is something I try to practice every day, to see my company through the eyes of an employee. What is it like to work for me?
Yeah.
What is it like to work for this company who's going through high growth phases of constant chaos, turmoil, not very well defined job descriptions, not very clear, you know, pictures of what exactly needs to happen next and what we're expecting of you right now that is always going to be that way. You know, we've had to deal with some of that in our business. There are people who love and thrive and do exceptionally good work in a very structured environment. And they need that structure in order to know where the boundaries are, what the expectations are, and know what the job is and know that I'm doing it well.
Right.
But you don't always have that in a high growth business.
It's like a startup, right?
Right.
Startup. That's some of the most exciting business to ever be in part of is a startup that's just starting to catch fire.
Mm-hmm.
But it is kind of chaotic. If you've read Elon Musk's book about Tesla and SpaceX, and it was just piecemeal together and working 20 hours a day and day on end and without didn't have a break for like 60 days or something. I mean, that so it can burn people out, but there's also an addiction to it. And so for me, so I go through those phases, but my company, Ashbusters, we're more of a mature company. Mm-hmm. So I don't have that startup burn feel. I've got a lot more systems and things in place. But I'll tell you kind of how it worked for me. The people that were with me early when we were burning and shaking, they couldn't stay on long term. They stayed for a while. And then the next crew came on, and what was the normal then, what was just out of control for the people before, that was normal. And then we moved to a new area of out of control, and then they moved on. But now that I've kind of settled that down, I've got some really long-term employees. I've got people been with me 10 years. And for me, that's long-term, because that's by the time I stabilize my rocket ship, you know, that launch pad for the first 3 miles, man, you burn up a lot of people too.
Yes.
It's part of the fuel.
And once you get out into there, it's, you know, you keep people longer and it's a softer journey, but there's also a danger in that. You know, you get complacent, you get, oh, it's easy. I've seen several business owners, like when their business gets there, they kind of step back and I can play golf a lot more, or I can go do this, or I can let somebody else totally run the business. And next thing you know, they look back at it, and that trajectory has gone south on them. And all of a sudden, they're re-entering orbit at a wrong angle. And the heat shields are catching on fire, and they got to get in and put them out. So, I love being comfortable at some points in my life, but I don't. You know, when my business gets there, I'm still looking to push it just enough.
Yeah. I'm right there with you. I hear it, but I've often wondered though, whether or not some of the people that didn't make it during those early startup phases of a business, whether they would make exceptionally good employees in the next phase of the business when you separate from the, from your,
they could have made it later.
Now you're in orbit. Now there's a stability I think some of those people would probably be exceptional employees at that point.
You know, I hadn't thought of that. I try to not burn bridges when I lose an employee. I mean, sometimes it doesn't go down well, but overall I like hearing from them and knowing what's happened to them. And I think though that I don't know that they could come back in at this place. Mm-hmm. I don't know, because they knew it then and they bring them back in. It's completely different. I remember when the guys used to come to my house to do my job, you know, when my business was at my house, and I'd handwrite whatever they had to do on a piece of paper and say, go do this. Now we're fully paperless, and it's just such a different business. You wouldn't even recognize it. They'd have to really totally regrip and retool, and maybe they could, but usually once they moved on, there was something that happened that just, and I blame myself for just as,
sure,
losing more employees than anything. Most of it's my fault.
Yeah. I don't favor going back, and revisiting, and pulling people back in. I'm not a sentimental business owner. I mean, I'm pretty much, okay, this is a decision we got to make. It's a hard decision, but it's the decision we got to make. And I don't tend to look back.
Yeah.
Ever. And I think most entrepreneurs are that way. I don't know, maybe.
A friend of mine that we all know, he says, I don't hire retreads.
Yeah.
Right. I like that. Well, it's really funny because I've heard you talk about how difficult it is making decisions to fire people, because you really are a very kind-hearted person.
Yeah.
I mean, seriously, you're a nice guy. I mean, and if anybody knows you, they'll always say, gosh, Mark Stoner, he's a nice guy. You know, and you really are a nice person.
Yeah.
And it's interesting because I've heard you talk about the cognitive dissonance that happens inside of you when this does.
Mm-hmm.
And it sounds like the conversations between the two of us, which is really comical.
Yeah.
Because I'm usually the one that's very quick to say, nope, gotta go, boom, I'm done.
Right.
And he's like, no, you know, that compassion, you know. So I'm working on my compassion part. It's one of our core values. So I'm not totally non-compassion, but I'm just a little bit quicker. But when Carter comes back and says, yeah, it's done, we're done, you know, is,
you know,
I
done.
Know, okay, yeah. It's time. And there's no question, because he really does do that. But we have each other. Mm-hmm. Tell me about who you talk to. I mean, you can't be going, this is nice Mark talking to the not so nice Mark.
Well, thank you. You're right. So, you know, I want to be a nice person. I have to be. I want to run a business, and it's people first and everything else is second. And if whatever, you know, everybody's got baggage and everybody's got strengths and weaknesses, and I genuinely like people. So if, you know, we're together, I'm going to always look for the things that I like about you, and the things that I might not like about you, I'm going to minimize it until it becomes just too much, and it's too much to bear, and it starts to hurt culture and everyone else.
Right.
So I do have, you know, my office manager, Vivian. I have a couple of other head lead technicians that will give me feedback, and I'll go back and forth. And I do have people to play off of a bit. At the end, where it ends for me is if it ever gets to a point of disrespect, if someone is really disrespectful, that just goes right through all my nice guy. Because I won't ever disrespect you. I will always hold you in the highest of respect. But if you don't act in kind with me, or I see it to other people, it really burns me up. Now, failures on the job and all kinds of other issues, that's not such a big deal. Let's fix that, and let's make new mistakes. You know? But if you're personally a bad person, or trying to be bad, or saying things, I have no tolerance for that. And that's my, you know, that's my Taylor side. Just jumps right out.
Yeah.
Says, that's done. We're done with that.
Yeah.
But if it's other things, I always wanted to be thought of as maybe good, but slow to react instead of fast react and losing good employees. You're like, man, I could have saved that relationship if I would have given them more heads up or handled that differently. And I don't ever want to look back and go, gosh, but I have looked back and go, man, I was terrible at that. But it's just part of the journey.
It's
right?
Learning, yeah. Right? Failing forward. You know, I mean, we do fail, but if we're learning something from it, I call them postmortems. You know, I do postmortems on every single, you know, big decision in our business when I feel like we've gotten a fair distance away from the moment when the decision was made.
It's important,
you know, to say, you know, was that, how could we have made that decision either sooner for better success faster, or how could we have slowed the process down so that we didn't react quite as fast, or what, you know, what are those questions? I mean, those are great questions to be asking about, because that helps develop you and sharpen those skills. Because, you know, Taylor and I talk about it all the time. Sometimes making a decision is better than not making a decision, no matter what the decision is, as long as you're making
one. Well, and also, like, so we're all learning these really tough leadership things. Well, so there might be people out there saying, you know, why would that affect me? But the truth is, what you're learning and what I'm learning will help us be able to lead more people, right?
Yes.
If you become a stronger leader, you can have a bigger tribe, you have more influence, you have more people that want to get behind you. And that's important, because if you have a mission, if you have a calling, if you have a business that is trying to get somewhere other than where you are right now, you're going to have to lead people.
That's right.
And so these lessons that you and I are going through, they're just going to help us in the future have more, you know, be more wise and be better people, be better bosses.
So does that mean in another 10 years you're going to write Blue Collar Gold 2, you know, version 2?
Well, there is a second book that once this goes, there is another book behind that about leadership.
Awesome.
You know, it's a Blue Collar Leadership. And I'm going to, I've talked to the publisher about it, and there's a few things in the Blue Collar, you know, Gold kind of family that we're going to go with.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Well, I think this is absolutely one of the books that should be on every single bookshelf for any blue collar service business owner. It's good for someone who's been doing it for 30 years.
Yeah.
It's good for someone who's thinking about doing it, but hadn't made the jump yet. There's good material in here, but mostly it's just the story of somebody who did it and the way that you did it. I really think it's a great contribution to our industries.
I'm excited to hear what people say about it. You know, there's that critics thing I'm a little worried about, you know.
Sure.
But I've never written anything, but thank you for that. I'm excited.
Yeah. And what is the actual launch date again?
It's July 26th. It'll be on Amazon for the first several like months. It's always going to be on Amazon, but trying to get an Amazon bestseller, you know, status.
Yep.
And it'll be available on markstoner.com as well.
Okay, awesome. So you check it out at markstoner.com. I know that the pre-order is there right now, but by the time this episode launches or airs, you may be able to just go directly to Amazon and get the book there, which we definitely
recommend. You can pre-order it. That would help.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
All right.
Now, one other thing I wanted to ask you about, switching gears a little bit, because this is interesting, and not everybody gets this opportunity, but you're actually going to be in an episode airing this fall in a show on CNBC called Blue Collar Millionaires.
Yeah, I am.
That's cool. And I've seen a few episodes, and they're pretty good. So tell us about that experience.
So it's funny. Like I said, poles in the water all of a sudden had fish on them. Well, a couple years ago, I got a call from there was a casting company that contacted the National Chimney Sweep Guild and some other places, says, hey, we're going to do a show on blue collar work, and we want to talk to some people who do things that people wouldn't think could be successful, you know, like, you know, say a janitor and these other things. And then, you know, chimney sweep came up in their thought process. So let's see if there's a chimney sweep out there that has been successful. So they started calling around. They got my name. They contacted me and said, hey, we've got a show. We think it's called Blue Collar Success Stories, but it's kind of hasn't been launched yet, so it's kind of secretive, and we don't really know what it's going to be called. But we love the story of a chimney sweep. Could you do a casting call with our casting people? We'll just do it over Skype. And so I did it, and they said, I love this story. I've had about, 20 meetings with them. And they're like, oh, we're going to have you on the pilot episode a couple years ago. Well, they were scheduled to come out on this Monday. On the Friday, they were scheduled to come out. They said, hey, it's scrapped. It was going to be on History Channel. They said, History Channel has pushed it back. It's not going to happen. Yeah. I said, oh, okay. We'll be there in a month. Well, a month turned into never. It went away. And then so I got a call the next year, similar idea, but it was called American Made. They said, we're going to launch the same idea. It's going to be called American Made. Would you be interested in being on the show? Yes. I keep saying yes. That didn't go anywhere. It stopped. Well, so then I saw Blue Collar Millionaires came out on CNBC last year, and I said, that's the show, but I didn't make it on it. The next producer, whoever took it over finally, I wasn't on their radar. So to make a long story longer, this year, a few months ago, the original producer called me and said, hey, Mark, this is Clay. I'm back on that show called Blue Collar Millionaires on CNBC. You're my favorite story from the earlier launch. Would you be willing to do it? I said, yes. Again, I said, but in the meantime, I've written a book called Blue Collar Gold, and he was super excited.
Awesome.
And I said, I've launched a franchise called Servant Chimney Inventing Franchise. And he said, great. So I went through all these background checks, all these, you know, back and forth. The whole time, I couldn't allow myself to be that excited because it'd been shut down so many times. Well, sure enough, 2 weeks ago, they showed up in Nashville with 7 guys and 30 cases of filming gear. And we filmed what I do for a living. We filmed a long interview session. We filmed what we do for fun. We filmed barbecue and me riding four-wheelers. And I also came to Nashville as a drummer. So we had a music store that had a drum set up, and we went in there and they showed me playing. And it's so humbling. It was, if there's ever a time in my life that it all came together, it was right then where somebody wanted to tell my story. It was important enough to tell what I'd gone through. Yeah. And if there was ever a time when you felt like you should feel like you've made it, it might be this year. but I still don't feel like that. Yeah, I feel like I got a lot of work to do.
Yeah, you got stuff going on, but stuff to do.
It was it's a neat thing. They were great guys. I don't know how it's going to come out and edit. I hope they do a good job telling this story. But they were fantastic, and it should come out in the fall. Okay. They didn't tell me any release date. I think the first episode's in September. I don't think I'm the first episode, but somewhere between September and, you know, the end of the year, it's going to air.
Okay.
Fantastic. Yeah. We got to be looking for that one.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then one other thing that you're doing that I think is really cool and we actually get to be a little bit of a part of, which is Blue Collar University. So yeah. Tell us a little bit about that.
So for years, I had invited people to come to my business. They came to Nashville and I said, hey, come and let me show you everything we do and let me give you all my best ideas and maybe we'll work on your business in a one-to-one kind of thing. And I did that for years, just, you know, anybody that wanted to come, because I want to help people. And a friend of mine, Clay Lamb, who's been on this show,
you bet.
He called it Mark Stoner University, and they called it MSU. And we did that for quite a while. And but then I decided to actually put it into a real format, you know, and we've moved forward with the Blue Collar Gold. And let's make this into, because there was a lot of people that really benefit from it. And teamed up with you guys. And as I'm starting to put this together, part of what I wanted to put together was what I know about marketing, but which grows less and less every day. But so we decided to have a 3-day camp. Come to Nashville, and I'll show you everything we do, from systems to operations to finance to, and you guys took over the marketing leg of it. Mm-hmm. And it's a super powerful 3-day powerhouse for your business. And I'm excited about it. And so far we've had a couple people come through it at this new format. Mm-hmm. And you know, they graduate and you know, they get a certificate.
That's
and
awesome.
It's a way to give back on a real personal level. I don't have a ton of time, but we've cut out some really nice slots for people to come through, and let's see if we can help these guys.
Yeah, I know. It's a powerful concept. I
mean, yeah.
We just went through something similar in our business with a marketing company that opened up the kimono and said, come on down and we're going to just sit for 3 days and we're going to show you everything. I mean, they opened up the books. They showed us their hiring policies, the way they train people, you know, just right down to the actual strategies and processes that they walk clients through. It was hugely beneficial for us to understand, number one, okay, we're not too far off the mark. We're kind of along the same trajectory as another company that's a little further along in the process. So just having gone through that ourselves, I know the power of that.
Why did they do that for you?
They, the same reason.
Just want to be good.
We've done a good job. We think we're proud of what we've done, but mainly we just want to help other people figure it out because that's what's needed in our industry.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Isn't it hugely, it's good. It's reassuring because some people come and they do things very well already, clearly. But to see whatever business you're in at a higher level is enlightening.
Yeah.
It's like, it just kind of blows the glass ceiling off of whatever you're looking at it. At one point, I was a one-man operation in my little bubble. That was as big as I could have. And my story is my whole world changed when I happened to open a magazine. A guy ran a 10-truck operation. As simple as that is, it changed. I was at the right place of my life to look at that and go, oh, I'm messing up. I got to think bigger. You know, I just was simply not thinking big enough. And that's another bad thing about small business owners is they think too small. And I've always said that about us chimney guys. I say, guys, we're some of the smallest thinkers I've ever been around. And for, you know, I run a 16-18 truck company, and for us to think that's gigantic, I think we got a problem with our thinking. I think, come on, guys. That's, you know, in this, and you know, there's HVAC companies that have hundreds of trucks.
Yeah.
And I know it's a different animal, but let's think bigger. You know, and that's what that does. You went to see those guys, and it can allows you to think bigger. If they can do it, I can do it.
Yeah. Sometimes you can't imagine what's outside the box until you step outside the box and see the way somebody else is doing it. And then you go, oh, and just those moments of clarity that it's like, okay, I think we've got a picture here that we can run with.
And it can be the simplest of things. Just that you walk through somebody else's business and they figured out something you were struggling with. And it just gave you, you know, years of your life back of having to go through the mistakes. You're like, oh, you do it that way. And that's what happens when people come to our business. The funny thing, sometimes guys come in and go, oh, I would never want a business this big. And I'm like, are you sure? how do you really know?
Because it actually is pretty cool.
Because they also, it's the easy way out, right? they go, I don't want to have to work that much.
Yeah. Yeah.
But when you get a really big team behind you, you can go so much faster.
Yeah.
There's, it's interesting because we've talked about this before, that journey of, you make a lot of money when you're a one truck guy.
Yeah.
And it's going straight into your pocket. And then you get two trucks and you're making about the same amount of money, but you've doubled your problems and three trucks, four trucks. And you can get to this point where you're miserable.
Yeah.
You're making less money than you've ever made. You've got triple or quadruple the number of problems and issues and taxes and everything else. But then you break through and now you're on the other side of that and you're ramping up even faster. You go from four or five trucks to 10 to 12 trucks really quickly.
That's right.
And you know, the momentum that you've got going, the return, you're starting to see systems getting in place. And as we've talked to you about what that's been like in your business, we've talked to other people too, and that's exactly the same. It doesn't matter what industry it is, slight different, differences, but in the whole, a truck-based business is going to have those same growing pains at around the same marks every single time.
Yeah, systems issues that happen in certain places. Just the process of the paperwork and the process of the work in general, you kind of become a processing company of paperwork coming in, paperwork going out, product coming in, product going out. And before it was like onesies and twosies when you're small, but pretty soon you've just got a workflow that you have to keep up with. And that's where the value of a business is too. That's where I can, if I wanted to, pull back and the thing runs just fine without me. Now, in my humble opinion, we wouldn't necessarily be as entrepreneurial minded and as early adopters necessarily as much. But as I said before, even my guys are trying to help me think ahead. So I have to think if I stepped back, there's other guys that go, okay, this was always the culture. This is what we always did. And I have similar values. And one of my values is we are early adopters of technology and new systems. We're going to be on the front edge. You're not going to beat us to the front edge. And so my guys all know that and they feel comfort in that. But on the backside, they know there's always going to be change.
Always
change.
Always change. What's this? Right. Doing this? What are we trying this week?
Here we go again.
Well, one of the great things in the experience that we had was the fact that they were able to keep such a strong culture through all the changes and through the growth. Mm-hmm. And that to me was one of the best things I learned because. Just to grow a company, to grow it, if your culture gets out of whack and it's no longer a place where you want to come to work, why grow it? I don't want to grow that kind of business. So it really kind of showed us that you could do it another way.
Well, and being guardians of your culture, at one point, if I was a weak leader, I could let somebody else that was kind of strong kind of start take over things, or I would see something but not really react to it. But now that I'm a lot stronger about making sure I have the right people and I don't let the bad people, mess with my good people, I had a very bad culture at one point. And I know I talked about that in a previous podcast that, it was terrible. Even I didn't want to go into my own business.
Yeah.
So, gosh, that's my fault, clearly. Mm-hmm. So now part of my thing is when I start seeing a little culture issue crop up, whether it be clickiness between technicians or, anger between office and that line starts to butt heads. I mean, I got to get that broken up and massaged out or sometimes remove people that you just can't. And so you become very protective of that. And it sounds like you saw a company that you can grow really quickly if everybody understands and enjoys where they work.
Yeah. Oh, and I totally agree. Yeah. And what we've found is our guys guard the culture probably better than we do.
Yeah, they see issues before we see them, and they're the ones that nip it in the bud. Hey, that's not how we do things here.
That's right.
Hey, this is our core value. This is not how we, you need to do it this way.
I saw that a lot. I used to do some work with some masonry and in the Spanish and Mexican, when they would come to work, you could hire just the one guy, and he would bring in all the people to work to help with the job.
Mm-hmm.
And very quickly, if one of his guys didn't work, he was gone. He replaced. They guarded their. Their culture, how they worked together. They were very much even stronger than we are. They didn't put up with as much as we do. They are hardworking people. Yeah. They're proud of what the work they do.
Yeah.
And so I saw them have their own little microculture just outside of where I was working. How they ran it tight. Yeah. Tight ship, man.
Yeah.
Tight ship.
Well oiled. Yeah. When everybody knows their place and everybody's doing the job. You know, watching that magic happen is truly a beautiful thing.
Yeah.
And you get one weak link in it. One person who's not doing it the way that everybody else is doing it. And man, it's a tragedy. It's just, it's like a train wreck that you can't look away from, you know?
And you got to make sure it's not you, too.
Yes.
That's it.
It's not the owner.
Yes.
But as a business owner, when you recognize that, ooh, I'm the weak link here, I got to step back and replace myself in this area.
Yes. I'm the bottleneck.
Yeah.
I'm the weak link. Yeah. And I told Taylor about this. Sometimes, you know, my office manager has to remind me to get out of her job. Yeah. Get out. This is my job, Mark, not yours. Why would you say this? Why would you do this? And that she's protecting, you know, it is part culture, but it's so relaxing to me. And I'm like, you're right.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Yeah. Sorry. I apologize. Yeah. I'll go do what I'm supposed to do and let you do yours.
In my lane, please. Yes. Sorry.
Yeah.
That's good.
Yeah. That's funny. Good.
Well, just having gone through a similar experience in our own industry, I know that any blue collar business at whatever level they're in is going to benefit from going through Blue Collar University, and the transparency, the authenticity, the vulnerability that you've kind of set up as part of that experience to go in and see it at a high level of what you're doing. You know, the good, the bad, the ugly. This is who we are right now.
Yeah.
But I think we've got something to offer. And if you pay attention, you're going to get the things that you need out of this to help you get where you want to go. I think it's great.
Thank you. You know, I pay myself a lot for education. As a business owner, I don't really need to be going to technical training anymore. Right. I don't need to go to whatever the way to do what, you know, whatever technical the best way to do this is. That is a waste of my time almost now, but I find a lot of owners still go to that training because it's their comfort level.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Well, this kind of training, Blue Collar University, is not that. If you come and want to jump in my trucks and run my guys, we got a problem. I mean, you can, but I know you're not focused on the right things. And so this is really good business training, which is rare. I don't know if actually there's anything out there like it, where you come into a working blue collar business and you see how they go from everything from taking the order, or well, from getting the phone to ring, to taking the order, to processing all the way through to how the money works, and how to do it again and again and again, you know, the attraction and retention.
Yep.
And so I don't know that this is out there. And I know if I would have found this early on, it could have saved me years of pain and helped me. You're going to spend the money one way or another. You're going to spend it in mistakes. You're going to spend it in education.
Right. Right.
And this is just a really cool high-level education that I don't think is out there. And you spend a few days, and it could absolutely give you years of your life back, get you to where you want to go so much faster.
Yeah.
And that's the end game, right? Is we want to get to a point where, and everybody's is different, but a point that business is delivering to you the life you wanted. That's the goal of the business. Well, in our world, for me, it's a certain level of income. It's a certain level of freedom. And many businesses don't deliver that for the owners. They deliver nightmares. They deliver hectic. They deliver working the guys to the bone. Man, if you want that, you probably shouldn't come to Blue Collar University. But if you want a different business, a true business, this is a great step.
Yeah.
It's a couple of days and your life will be changed, I promise.
Yeah, it's high value and really compact and intense. I think it's going to be an incredible thing. And I know we're working on getting that information put up specifically and described well as a program on markstoner.com, but it's not there yet. So if somebody wanted to get in touch with you and find out more about it, I would just encourage them to use the contact form on markstoner.com.
Or my assistant with Blue Collar University is hope@markstoner.com.
Okay.
And she is one of those fantastic people that make things that happen. And she is the one who takes it from there and gets all the information, dates, schedules. You know, it's super fun. We have you come into Nashville. Nashville's such a vibrant town. So many things happening here. Mm-hmm. We spend a few days showing you operations. We show you everything we do. The second day with us, we will go through your business. We will set organizational charts for you. We find out where you want to go with it. We get a real game plan with a real timeline, with a real a way for you to get there. And in the meantime, we barbecue, we'll have dinner, and then I turn them over to you guys. You guys go through their marketing plans, their strategies, how to bring more people in, how to retain those people, and how to budget for that. And many times, a lot of blue-collar business guys have never talked to anybody about any of this.
Right.
They've never had a marketing plan or strategy or budget. They've never drawn out an org chart of what this business is going to look like in 1 to 5 to 10 years. This is a lot of times the first time they've ever done any of this stuff. And you're going to come out of this with a new excitement. It's going to be like like somebody lit a fire under you. You're going to be ready to hit the road.
Yeah, hard. That's awesome. And it's not just the want to, the desire, but now you can map that desire directly to an actionable plan.
Yes.
That gets you where you're saying
here's
you want to go.
And you got to have a plan.
Yeah, I mean, that's the thing. People don't realize that all three of us can plan a trip to the same destination, and left on our own accord, can do it any way we want. And I can go up through Canada, you can go through Mexico to get to LA, and you may hop on a plane and go straight through. And a lot of it depends on how do you want to get there?
Yeah.
You know, so if you want the shortest, sweetest, directest way to get to where you want to go, then Blue Collar University, I think, is a great place to either start, or if you're in the middle and you're finding yourself in Canada and can't seem to get, you know, wherever you are, want to get there, then I think that it's a wonderful way to do there, you know, to do it, is to come to somewhere where you've got a real plan and,
yeah,
and well, direction.
You know this about me, I like barbecue. Well, yeah. In the barbecue world, I was competing a lot, and I wasn't doing that well in pro barbecue. I would sometimes do well sporadically, mm-hmm. but I was pretty much on the bottom half of the class, and I just kept seeing these guys winning and winning and winning, and I paid to go to barbecue school.
There you go.
You know, some of these champion barbecue guys uh-huh. have these schools. You come in and spend a couple of days, and they show you everything. Oh my gosh.
Yeah.
The very next contest we were in, we're in the top 10. We would win categories. We consistently were better on every time we went out because they showed me some methods and a couple things I was just missing, those
yeah.
little things. I would be in these competitions and say, why are these guys just keep beating me? Their food can't be that much better. Their mm-hmm. present, guess what? It wasn't a lot better, but it was those little tweaks
yeah.
that made them win and made me spend thousands of dollars on a weekend and lose.
Right.
And,
right.
And as a metaphor, that's exactly what this Blue Collar University is.
Yeah,
I'm going to show you
great.
How to win. I'm going to
yeah.
show you those little things, and you're going to show them what you guys dealt with hundreds of businesses,
yep.
and you know those little methods and tweaks that make the difference between spending a lot of money mm-hmm. and making a lot of money.
Yep. Yeah. And that's where it comes down to.
Well, Mark, it's exciting to be a part of your world, man, and be especially at this stage as things are just now launching yeah. and really getting going. So
you guys are a big part of my world, and I'm so thankful for you guys on so many levels, just as friends and as business associates. It's a very great relationship. So
yeah, well, that is a very mutual feeling.
Yes,
absolutely. So thank you for coming on the show. If you want to connect with Mark, markstoner.com is the best place to do that. Find out about his book. Definitely pre-order a copy. Learn a little bit more about Blue Collar University. And don't forget in the fall, just find him on the Blue Collar Millionaires too. So,
yeah.
And we're going to watch you, man. You're a part of our world and and what's going on here. We're going to get you back on the show soon, I'm sure.
Oh, thank you so much.
He may be invited to go to the moon next time. Who knows?